Good afternoon. I'm delighted to welcome you today to the MacLean Center series on ethical issues in end-of-life care. Next Wednesday, let me mention that Professor Dan Brudney from the philosophy department. Is Dan in the audience?
Yes.
Dan, where's Dan? Oh, there, Dan. We'll be speaking on the topic of democratic legitimacy and end-of-life decisions. Now, it's important that you note that our talk next week will not be in this room, but will be in room H103, so that there will be a change in room. We'll have a sign-up about that, but if you can just note it. Today, it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Bill Meadow. Bill is a professor of pediatrics and the director of the Neonatology Fellowship Program here at the university. Bill earned his MD at the University of Pennsylvania, completed residencies at the University of Chicago and Children's Memorial, and then did a fellowship in infectious disease and neonatology here at the university, and then a fellowship in clinical medical ethics at the MacLean Center. Dr. Meadow's research focuses on medical ethics in the field of neonatal epidemiology. He has examined issues of resource allocation and informed consent in the NICU. Bill has also been a major contributor, maybe the major contributor, to our knowledge about prognostication for children in the NICU setting. His crystal ball study, which has worked both in the pediatric neonatal unit and in the medical ICU, I think with Jesse, collaboration, has been a groundbreaker in terms of prognostication for patients who are hospitalized. Bill has published many articles and book chapters, and the book that he co-authored with Dr. John Lantos, a book entitled Neonatal Bioethics, The Moral Challenges of Medical Innovation, is a classic in the field. Today, Bill will speak to us on the mathematics of morality in the NICU. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Bill Meadow.
And right where's the bottle, I can put out another $20, try to win my $20 back that I lost this morning in talking to the fellows. Anyway, the title of the talk is The Mathematics of Morality. This is your standard ethics thing that nobody pays ethicists anything, and I won't be talking about meds. This is a slide that often appears at the end of talks. I like to put it at the beginning of talks. These are many of the people who've helped me at the University of Chicago, which is a very strange place, but one of the things that it does do well is that it has great people to help. These are three people who are not at the University of Chicago. Annie Janvier is a neonatologist in Montreal. Joanne Legata is at the Medical College of Wisconsin. She was here both as a resident, as a fellow. And John Lantos, as Sieg's mentioned, is, I think, without question, is Laney in the audience? I didn't see it, so if Laney's not in the audience, I'll say that John Lantos is unquestionably the most eminent pediatric ethicist in the world today. And we'll go from there. If suddenly you were forced to think hard about extremely premature infants, what would you want to know? What would you want to know if you were a doctor, a health policymaker, or a parent? Well, if you're a doctor, you might want to know how frequently babies like this were born, how frequently they lived and died, how long they stayed in hospital, how they did if they survived. These are the sort of standard things that are written about in the medical literature in terms of neonatal medical outcomes. Policymakers have two other issues that they talk about. One is, how much did these babies cost? And the second is, how do these expenses compare to other public health expenses, either in children or in adults? Parents only want to know one thing. They want to know, what will happen to my baby? Not 100 more or less similar babies, but what will happen to my baby? And if you were a parent, when would you want to know that answer? Well, there are a number of different times. We're going to talk about this in somewhat more detail. But as a general principle, you might want to know before birth, and there's a bunch of people in the audience who do this for a living, both as neonatologists and neonatology fellows, and we'll talk about the antenatal consults that we give. You might want to know in the delivery room in the context of whether or not you should begin or continue neonatal resuscitation. What about after several days in the NICU with what you can learn from a trial of therapy? And finally, at the time of NICU discharge, and we'll talk a bit about the pluses and the minuses in terms of counseling at the time of NICU discharge. So here's my central claim. It's a claim that I brought up a little bit when Joel Frater, who many of you were here last week, talked on pediatric end-of-life care. It is, I don't know if it's an outrageous claim, but certainly a claim that I strongly believe. We talked a bit about it this morning. Don't tell Joel this, I don't think there's anything interesting about pediatric end-of-life care. And what I mean by that is that I think it's absolutely identical to adult end-of-life care. But I think neonatal end-of-life care is markedly different. And the reason that I think they're different is easy to articulate. I think that the most salient decision in end-of-life decision-making, both for adults and for older children, is, are you going to go back to the hospital to get more care, or are you going to stay at home or a nursing home and pass away comfortably without medical intervention? That, to me, is the single decision that's most important in end-of-life or hospice or whatever you want to call it, decision-making. And that's the same in older children as adults, but it's not the same in the NICU. Because in the NICU, you've never been home. In the NICU, you're always there. And so we in the NICU simultaneously give supportive care, medical interventions, ventilation, TPN, all this stuff, and hospice care when it's appropriate. And that, I think, accounts for the fact that when you take all these surveys about end-of-life care and hospice and all this stuff, most physicians in most specialties think that they're under-trained, underexposed, they don't quite know what to do, they could use help. There are hospice services and palliative care teams, and Joel runs the one at Lurie, and there are people here who do it. And when you survey neonatologists, they just don't care. They're not interested in getting help from the outside for end-of-life care. We almost never call end-of-life consults. We don't care because we think we don't need it. It's what we do for a living. We have 50 deaths a year in the NICU, many more deaths than there are certainly in all of the rest of COMAR. Now, there may be COMAR patients who die at home. In fact, many of them, in theory, should die at home. But we see death a lot, and we get used to managing it, and there aren't quite the same kinds of concerns. Now, I'm going to make a lot of fun of Jesse over the course of this talk, but it's easy. He's right there. He runs our MICU, and I'm going to talk on a number of different occasions about distinctions between how the NICU, neonatal intensive care unit, and the MICU, which is the medical intensive care unit, which is for adults, work. I used to, when I was younger, be much more cavalier in making fun of the MICU, but as I'm getting older and could keel over at any moment, I'm much less comfortable mocking everything that Jesse has done for his entire career, because I may need him really soon. Okay, so, in our world, end of life is the other point to be made, and it's an important point, is that NICU end of life care is different from all other end of life cares because in our world, the end of life is not the outcome to be most feared, either by docs or by parents. Rather, devastated survivors are generally considered to be the worst possible outcome. So John Lantos had a lovely poignant phrase, which is that before the NICU, before neonatology, all of CP was God's fault. After neonatology, half of CP is our fault. And the single most powerful emotion in the field of neonatology, without question, is guilt. Okay? That is the emotion that we deal with every single day we're on service. And the reason we deal with it is because, unlike in adults, where we pediatricians sometimes sit in the back, I try not to tell this to Siegs and try to hide it from the fellows until they get longer into their months. Okay, but sometimes we play like little bingo in the back when they hand out the cases, right? And if the first line of the case is 88-year-old patient, right, we're done. Right. There's nothing else interesting about that case from our perspective. Now, I know you're not supposed to say it, but in fact, it is how we often feel. Because these patients, for the most part, are going to die. The vast majority of our ethics consults are about end-of-life decision-making. And in our world, it just doesn't matter who decides whether they die this week or next week. Nick Christakis, who used to be here and then was deemed, hard as it is to believe, too full of himself to be at the University of Chicago, so he went to the only other institution in America where you can be even more full of yourself and comfortable, and that would be Harvard. And he and I used to teach lecture together in Siegs's course to the first year medical students, where we would talk about using the D word, right? Because Nick is famous for saying the physicians are imperfect at counseling parents, patients, and telling them they're going to die, that they don't use death and dying frequently enough, and that physicians are imperfect at predicting death, okay, and they usually overestimate how long patients are going to live and stuff like that. And I remember vividly a terrific scene. A med student, a first-year med student, it was a brilliant question, just interrupted him right in the middle of his talk and said, so do you think it's good or bad for the patients that doctors are overly optimistic? And he was taken aback. He said, you know, I've never thought about that. And I thought it was a terrific question by this medical student because it got to the heart. Now, I didn't make fun of him then, although I made fun of him at many other times, that, you see, in our neonatology world, all of these adult issues pretty much don't matter because the patients are all going to be dead in 6 months. Okay. Whereas for us, they matter because these patients may be alive for decades. And so assessing that is our biggest end-of-life issue. Okay. And with that, we're going to press forward and talk a little bit more about data. There are at least four distinct data-related issues as they impact the morality of NICU care. There's money, there's outcomes, there's prediction, and there's worth. And today, ready for this? Is this like, huh? Is that like awesome PowerPoint skill? You like this? First it's all dark, then, huh? I know how to do this. I remember the Cahokia Indians crossing over the, that's another story I'll tell you later. Okay, anyway, today I'm only gonna talk to you about money and prediction. Another time, perhaps, if you'd like, we can talk about outcomes and moral worth of patients. So I'm going to talk about money and prediction, both in the NICU and in the adult ICU, and give you a feel both for the kinds of data that we gather to give you a feel for how you can talk about medical ethics from a data-based relationship. That's the kind of thing that youngsters might learn and want to do for field and to give the rest of you a perspective. Okay, so I'm going to talk about money first. Here's the numbers for perspective. We're going to split the room right down the middle. Sigs, you can count the numbers. You guys can be one team, you guys can be another team. This is audience participation. I learned from my children's kindergarten classes, you can't be like team A and team B because you would feel bad, or team one and team two. So you guys are the suns, you guys are the moons. Ready? Go. In the United States every year, how many babies are born? Oh, all right, so the moons, one. Sikhs, pay attention. You don't know the answer to any of these, just pay attention. So 4 million is the answer. What is it? What is it is a bad question. Okay, how many people die in the US every year? Good. Oh, we have some ringers here. These health study types. But you're right in the middle, so I don't know how to count you. Okay, right. So I counted as 3 million, but between 2.5 and 3 million people, okay, die every year. Now, how many babies are born under 1,000 grams?
60,000.
Good. Oh, Mike Masal, the moons are stacked here. Well done, Mike. Okay, so I counted a little less than that, Mike. I counted 40,000, but it's about that. It's about 1% of all the babies born. And there's really about 4.2 million born, so it's a little more than that. Okay, now they get a little harder. How many babies die in the U.S. every year? Not eventually, right? Eventually we know. But during the neonatal period. Right. Yeah? You should know this. Who said that? Well done, sons. So that's about right. So it's about 0.6%, 6 per 1,000 of 4 million. Excuse me. So it's about 24,000 babies die every year. Next question, how many babies under 1,000 grams die? Now, there are two ways to get the answer to this. One is, of all the babies who die, 24,000 or so, how many die from complications of prematurity? Okay, there are only two reasons in America that babies die. What are they? No, not trauma. See, you just stop. Just keep counting. You're not going to know any of these answers. Right. So one is complications of prematurity, and the other is genetics, congenital anomalies. Mike is like, he's like a ringer planted in this talk. This is great. Yes, congenital anomalies. Okay, here's an interesting question. Over the years, so first of all, how many die, roughly what's the percentage of die from prematurity versus congenital anomalies? Yes, it's about 50-50, which is surprising. Most people think there's many more for preemies, but it's not. Over the years, how do you think that ratio has changed? More? Yeah, you might think so, but in fact, the ratio has been the same for about 40 years. So we're better caring for preemies, but also fewer children with congenital anomalies die. Why is that? So you might think we're better at taking care of them with surgery and ECMO, but that's not the big reason. Right, the big reason is antenatal termination. Okay, and so those numbers have stayed the same for about 40 years. So babies under 1,000 grams die. Well, one way to say it is about half of all the babies who die die of prematurity. So it's about 12,000 or a third of all the babies who are born under 1,000 grams. So here's another question. This is like double round here. What percentage of NICU resources are devoted to ELBW, that's extremely low birth weight, so that's under 1,000 grams, non-survivors as opposed to resources devoted to ELBW babies who survive to discharge? So babies are born under 1,000 grams. There are 1% of 4 million, so there's 40,000. Some of them die. Some of them live. We spend money on both. Of all the money we spend on those babies, what percent goes to babies who are non-survivors? 10 cents of every dollar, 50 cents of every dollar, or 90 cents of every dollar on non-survivors? Yeah. So very good. 10 cents of every dollar. So here's a slide. These data are from our institution. Most of the data I'm going to show you from our place. I'll tell you when they're not. So this is birth weight on the x-axis, mortality on the y-axis. The gray bars are percentage of babies who die, but the blue bars are the percentage of dollars spent on non-survivors. And you can see that at the high birth weights, where mortality is quite low, well, obviously, we don't spend much money on dying babies. But look over here. Even where mortality is high, we spend very little money on dying babies proportionately. How can that possibly be? Yes, because dying babies die quickly. The smallest and the sickest die the quickest, and survivors stay in the NICU a long, long time. Okay. So neonatal intensive care, from that perspective, is well apportioned to survivors as opposed to non-survivors. And now this is the first time of several that I can make fun of Jesse. Okay, so we did the same study in our adult ICU, and here are the data. On the top of the NICU data, split into high risk, medium risk, low risk, and the bottom are our adult data, high risk, medium risk, low risk. So look at the babies, even the highest risk babies, where 70% will die, 10% of the dollars are spent on non-survivors. And in every risk group, the blue bars are lower than the gray bars. But look at the adults. At every risk group, you spend relatively more money on dying adults than non-dying adults. And by the highest risk group, 70 cents of every dollar spent in the adult MICU on the highest risk patients are spent on patients who are going to die before they get out of this hospital. Okay. That's an important distinction between NICU care and adult care from a financial perspective. Here's a slide I like to show. This is sort of my Rambo 1 escape slide. So this is the likelihood of survival with every passing day for NICU patients versus adult patients. The NICU is in gray. So even if you take a high-risk group where on day of life one only 25% will survive, with every passing gray, look at the gray, day, look at the gray bars. If you don't die in the NICU with every day, you're more and more likely to go home. Now look at the blue bars. Those are Jesse's unit. I don't want to personalize it, but it is your unit. Okay, every day you don't get out of the ICU, you're less and less likely to ever get out of the ICU. Okay, so here's the summary about money. We spend 10 times more on dying MICU patients than dying NICU patients. And There are 100 times more dying adults than dying infants. We already decided that 2.5 million people die and 25,000 of them are babies, and the other 2.4 something million are adults. Yes, we spend more, relatively more on dying adults because it's disproportionately more on dying ICU adults than dying, than living ICU adults. Yes. Yep. Yep. So there are no credible financial arguments against neonatal intensive care. So if you're ever at a cocktail party and people say, oh, you spend way too much money on those babies, okay, just stick to your guns. JDP, you should like diss all the people at the cocktail party and just mock them and say, if ICU cost savings are to be desired, they should be found in adult ICUs, not in NICUs, right? There is one politician in America who has embraced this theory vividly. Yeah, anybody know who it is? It was the governor of Colorado about 20, 30 years ago. And actually, his name escapes me now, but I'll think of it. Yes, that's right. Yeah, you knew this? Yeah, it's true, Lamb. And so he said this, and he was ex-governor by the next election because preemies don't vote and old people do. And so it turns out you can make some quick calculations of, and David Meltzer has done this among many others. So what percentage of adults are hospitalized in an ICU in their last year of life? That's high, 70% is high. Some people say 20 or 30% of adults will go to an ICU, but 50% will go to some hospital, and about 20 or 30% will go to, okay. And so if we could cut the costs even of that subpopulation, okay, by attempting to predict who's gonna die successfully, we could save a lot of money for healthcare costs. And so the next question that arises is, can we predict successfully? And that's what we're gonna talk about now, okay. We're going to talk about two things in predicting outcomes, timing and positive predictive value. I'm not going to spend forever on this. Just very quickly for some of the young ones, positive predictive value is a forward-looking statistic. I stand here in the present, I make a prediction, then I walk to the future, I turn around, and I say, was my prediction right? How many times out of 100 was my prediction right? That's different from sensitivity, which is often found in the medical literature, which I'm not going to talk about today. And timing, obviously, is when it matters. So stick with me. If you looked at your predictive value data and you only started making predictions when patients were severely bradycardic, hypoxic, and had no blood pressure, your positive predictive value would be excellent, right? But probably ethically irrelevant. And so what we're trying to do is be a little better than that. Okay, this is a terrific slide. Joanne Legata invented this slide. I'm gonna spend a little time on it. Okay, it's outcome prediction in neonatology, a proposed timeline. There are at least four different times when you can talk to parents or other physicians and decide and discuss what the likely outcome is gonna be. The first one is antenatally. This is what my fellows do. There's some fellows here today. And what they do is they are called by the obstetricians to please go. I'm just gonna grab a little water here before I aspirate and have to go to Jesse's unit. If I'm nasty to him, he won't take me. Mm. If I drink it fast, I'll aspirate. Okay, anyway, so antenatally, you get called by the obstetricians, please come and talk to this mother, she's threatening premature delivery. And the big question that is asked in for babies who are born around the threshold of viability is, should we resuscitate them at all? The alternative is to not resuscitate them, at which point they would die with comfort care. The question is, what do we know when we do antenatal counseling? And these are sort of the four, or there's actually one more, things that we use when we do antenatal counseling. Gestational age is important, whether or not the mother got antenatal corticosteroids, which mature the fetus. Twins as a general principle, are more at risk than singletons. Small, undergrown babies do worse, and gender. Okay, so girls do better than boys at most gestations. Indeed, many women in the audience would say, for the indefinite future, girls do better than boys. And I can certainly understand that argument. Okay. So we use these data, and we'll talk a bit about how well these data can help us predict what's gonna happen to the babies. Okay, sometimes you can add a little information in the delivery room. Well, mostly what you add in the delivery room is how the baby looks. And how the baby looks has two parts to it. One is, can you confirm the gestational age is about what we expected? And the other part is, can you see if the baby looks vigorous or not? And the single best way we found to quantify how vigorous the baby is by the APGAR score, which you're all familiar with. It's a score of basically vigor of an infant. And so you get all the things that are down their gestational age and twins and stuff like that. Plus the APGAR score, Jaideep Singh, who's in the audience today, published a lovely paper about how much physicians look at the APGAR score around the time of deliveries to influence whether or not they should continue the resuscitation, even though the data are that the APGAR scores in the first few minutes are pretty useless as long-term predictors. The third time you could think about how to gather data to predict is in the NICU during what we call a trial of therapy. And here's an important point, and it's important even when we compare our data to Jesse's data. In the NICU, a trial of therapy can be considered to be any time from time one until the day before they're discharged. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about while a baby's on a mechanical ventilator. And the reason that we say that is because then there's an ethical alternative. You could extubate them, withdraw the mechanical ventilation, and the presumption is the vast majority who are on a ventilator need to be on a ventilator, and if you stop the ventilation, they would pass. So redirecting to comfort care while a baby is on a ventilator. Once they're off a ventilator, then you have a very different task, okay? Because it becomes much more difficult to withhold other things. It's very difficult in our world to withhold feeding and nutrition because most, even healthy babies, get fed from the outside. It's not like adults. And so while a baby's on a ventilator, can we learn something about how they're going to do? And there are at least a couple of ways to do it. One is an illness severity score. We use the SNAP score from neonatal acute physiology. It's actually, we inherited them from the adult ICU, from the Apache scores. There's other things we can do. We'll talk a little bit about clinical intuitions and head ultrasounds as well. Finally, there's the time of NICU discharge. Now, at the time of NICU discharge, you know a lot. Because you see, they've been in the NICU the whole time. They're off the ventilator now. The vast majority of babies don't go home on a ventilator, so they're off the ventilator. So the problem is, although you know a lot, it's too late. You can't do anything other than refer them to Mike Massal because you're not allowed, you're not allowed to smother them with a pillow. And so in that context, I didn't say that. Okay, but the idea is that in that context, all you can do is refer them to early intervention. You can love them, you can hug them, you can support the parents in their difficult times. But you don't have any alternative to keeping the babies alive, okay? And so although the data are excellent, okay, it's too late from an ethical perspective. And so now what I'm gonna say is that this time, you like this? This is a square, a rectangle, 50% transparency, huh? These are the kind of things you learn in talks. You learn PowerPoint, and there's another 50% transparency, right? I'm gonna say that these are too early, and we don't know enough. And this is too late, and although you know more, it's not helpful, and that this is the time that we should be doing most of our counseling because we'll learn more, and yet there's still alternatives. So now I want to talk about predicting mortality while a baby's on a ventilator in the NICU. There are algorithms, this is because it's an IBM. If it were a Mac, it would say 1 and 2. I don't know why this is 1 and 1. Okay, anyway, there's algorithms and there's intuition. So an algorithm is easy. Okay, from the Apache or for the SNAP score, you get points if you're sicker. So if you're hypotensive, you get points. If you're sodium sucks, you get points. Hypoglycemia, you get points. If you're on catechols, you get points. If you're on a ventilator, you get points. The more sicker you are, the more points you get. Okay, and so, therefore, it ought to be easy. We showed a long time ago, and the Apache people showed too, that if you're sicker at the time of entry to the NICU or to the MICU, you're more likely to die than if you're less sick. That's not a shock. Okay. But let's press it further. Well, sicker patients should get sicker and sicker and sicker before they die, whereas the survivors should get healthier and healthier and healthier while they live. So not only should day of life one illness severity scores be useful in distinguishing two groups, but serial illness severity scores ought to be terrific. They ought to be the way we can distinguish babies who are going to live from babies who are going to die. And so when you look at algorithms, that's another slicky thing. Okay, here's what we showed. We were completely wrong. Okay, and when we found these data, we couldn't believe it, so we went back and looked again. Okay. Day of life is on the x-axis. The y-axis is the illness severity score. The red line is for non-survivors. The gray line is for survivors. The reds and the grays, or blue, depends on which one you look at, are clearly significantly different at the time of birth. And over time, the distinction narrows. It doesn't get wider. How can that possibly be right? And the answer is, because all survivors, stick with me, survive. And so the N of the gray bars is the same at every day of life. But the sickest non-survivors die. And so the N on day of life one is different from the N of day of life three. And the ones with the highest SNAP scores are gone. And day of life seven still. And so serial illness severity scores are useless in distinguishing babies who are going to die in the future. Okay, and that was a big surprise. This is a slide I just want to show you. I get points for having made this graph. I made this graph in Cricut Graph. It's really hard to do. Cricut Graph is not supported, by the way, although it was a wonderful thing. Anyway, the X's have to do with babies who are normal, and the triangles have to do with babies who are either dead or impaired. And what you can see is very quickly by day three and day five, okay, there are as many X's up top at the highest scores as there are triangles. And so the prognostication becomes less and less good. Okay. Well, maybe I don't need no stinking algorithms. Maybe I just know this kid's going to live, this kid's going to die. Maybe I know that. Okay. So we've been doing this at U of C for a long time now, 15 years, maybe more. And what we do is we walk around on every day, we identify all the babies on mechanical ventilation, and we ask them, the docs, the nurses, the NNPs, the attendings, the fellows, the residents, one question. Do you think this baby's going to survive to discharge or die in the NICU? For the methodologists in the crowd, the most important methodologic insight is candy. If you walk around with a bucket of candy, people will come and answer your questions. You give them a piece of candy, it's really cheap. If you don't have candy, okay, the people won't come and they won't listen. Apparently, I just learned this morning that the adult ICU people take more than one piece of candy for each. I just learned that from my informant in the MICU. Whereas in the NICU, they're more polite. And they'll take only one piece of candy to give you information. So anyway, the point is that you get intuitions about what people think. This kid's going to die. This kid's going to live. OK. So here's a quiz question. This is for those of you, just to give you a feel for how the NICU works. What percentage of ventilated NICU babies under 1,500 grams are never predicted to die? So you're sick enough to be in the NICU on a vent, and yet nobody ever says you're going to die. Make a guess. Good, good guess, 50%. So it's actually a little higher, but it's not much higher. So being on a vent in the NICU is no big deal, okay? A lot of our kids are on a vent. They're easy to manage. They're, you know, like interns cases. We don't worry much about them. And here, this is a distribution. It's about a third, a third, a third of the other half of increasingly stringent predictions of die. The blue one, 15% of the patients, one person said, I think the patient's going to die. The green one is two people on the same day said, I think the patient's going to die. And the yellow one is everybody on the team that day said, I think the patient's going to die. OK. So how well did the predictions of die actually predict death? Well, 60% of all the babies were never predicted to die. How did they do? Yeah, good for you. They lived. OK, so almost all survived. Stick with me. If 60% were never predicted, then 40% were predicted to die. You can do that math. I'll give the sons an extra point for that. OK, so how did these kids do? Get worse. OK, half of these survived as well. So imagine this conversation. I go to a mother and I say, ma'am, I'm Dr. Meadow. I'm your attending physician. You know your baby's really sick. In fact, I think your baby's going to die. Other people on our team also think your baby's going to die. You should know that at the University of Chicago, we do research on this question, and I'm wrong half the time. So it has a different kind of feel to it than other ethical kinds of discussions would have with parents. And it suggests that there may be a flaw or a problem with our using this data set for any kind of counseling. Here's a cross-cultural tidbit that has to do with the MICU. Okay, so in the MICU, we learned quickly that being on a vent wasn't that big a deal. You could stop intensive care for MICU patients whether they're on a vent or not in a way that doesn't happen in the NICU. Okay, so we studied all MICU patients. And in fact, although we don't tell people this, so will you don't go back and like spill the beans here, we only analyzed MICU patients who've been in the MICU for more than 3 days. And the reason we did was we and others have shown, both in Jesse's units and in other units, that MICU populations can quickly be divided. A lot of patients who get admitted to the MICU, the adult ICU, get out in 3 days. In fact, more than half the patients are discharged in 3 days, and almost all of them live. They are not ethically problematic. They come in for whatever reasons you guys do. You do a great job, and they're out. Okay. So we're only interested in MICU patients who are there from 96 hours on, 4 days or more. Okay. So what percentage of MICU patients who were predicted to die by docs, by nurses, by attendings, by fellows, actually died in the MICU? It died before hospital discharge. So they were predicted, this patient's going to die before hospital discharge. What percentage actually did? Yeah, you'd think so. So you're wrong. It's half. It's just the same. Okay, but look what's different. Here's the crucial difference between the NICU and the MICU. We did a second study that Jesse's team and I, we just recently published within the last year. 95% of the patients in the MICU who are predicted to die are dead by 6 months. So whether they die in the hospital, or they go to an LTAC, or they go home to hospice, or they go to a nursing home, or they go somewhere, they die. But in the NICU, that's not true. Half of the patients, almost all of the patients who survive to NICU discharge will not die quickly. Okay, the post-NICU discharge death rate in the first year of life is less than 10%. So the vast majority of NICU survivors will live for at least a year or many years, whereas in the adult unit, they're all dead by 6 months, which is why I now am showing you data to suggest that we pediatricians or neonatologists are right to mock all of these consults, okay, about end-of-life decision-making in adults, because it doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. Okay. So now I want to talk a little bit more about some more subtle things we've done, and then get to sort of a little bit of ethical nub before we're done. So maybe you guys, we, didn't really suck when I said we were wrong half the time. Maybe I was looking at the wrong outcome. Maybe a better outcome would be the combined, what we call an adverse outcome, which is either you're dead or you're significantly impaired at 2 years of age. Okay, well, we can have a debate about what significant impairment means for the rest of this talk. It's that your MDI and your PDI, which are your Bayley scores, are less than 70, which is more than two standard deviations below the mean, at 2 years corrected age. We can talk about whether that's an appropriate use later. Mike Massal, who's in the audience, has terrific data that maybe that's not a great thing, but it is by far the most common one. That's what we're going to talk about for the next 15 or 20 minutes. Okay, while a baby's on a ventilator. Okay, oh no, I don't know why this is one and two and the other one wasn't. Never mind. Okay, what data? We might use intuitions or algorithms. I'm going to tell you for free that I told you algorithms were terrible for predicting death. They're even worse for predicting death or impairment. Okay, so we're not even going to talk about the algorithm data, although I have them. We're going to do just intuitions. It's the same question. See, we walk around, we ask people, is this baby going to live or die? But then we look at a different outcome. Okay. And in addition, we added one thing. This is Joanne Legata's fellowship thesis. We added head ultrasounds. And head ultrasound is easy. It's just an ultrasound. The vast majority of you know what an ultrasound is. It's sort of a video of the inside of the head. And we look to see bleeding. That's what we're looking for the most part. Okay. And look what we found. These are some of the coolest data in the neonatal prognostication indicator. This is not a surprise. As your head ultrasound gets worse going to the right, the likelihood on the y-axis of either death or impairment goes up. So normal head ultrasound, still it's not so wonderful, right? 40% of little babies with a normal head ultrasound, these are all kids under 1,000 grams from our institution, have an outcome of either death or impairment, going up to severe where it's about 80 to 85%. That's not a shock. But look what we gain when we add into it, our intuitions. This is what you gain. Okay, the gray bars here are just the same head ultrasounds than the light blue. One person on one day thought the baby was going to die. The agreement is more than one person. We had a corroborated. Two people at least thought the baby was going to die on at least one day. And the red bars are everybody on the team thought the kid was going to die. And look what we learned. We learned that for every degree of head ultrasound, your intuitions add predictive power. And look what else we learned. It's not just that the predictive power is better. It's terrific. So that if you have a look at the red and the green bars together, for mild, moderate, severe, any degree of abnormal head ultrasound. So now we have, ma'am, I'm Dr. Meadow. You know your baby's really sick. In fact, I and other team members think your baby is going to die. We, University of Chicago, have looked at these data, and the likelihood that your baby is going to be alive and neurologically normal when the baby is two is 4%. Do we want to keep going, or do we want to redirect care? That, I would argue, is a profoundly different conversation to have with a mother than a conversation about it's 50-50. Indeed, that's why we're doing this, because the 50-50 stuff is just imperfect. When you do 23 or 24 weekers, it's about 50-50. Hi, ma'am, do you want to start intensive care on your baby? Take a coin and flip it. That's what we know about your outcome. That's just not good enough. Okay, how much better are these predictors than just gestational age? What Kelly or Marin do when they walk over to the OB side and talk to the mothers? These are some way cool data. So these are 177 kids in our place, and the black bars now are 23 and 24 weekers, and the striped bars are 25, 26, and 27 weekers. Mortality or abnormal MDI is on the y-axis. And here's the first thing you find, okay, that this is what you knew already. If you're born at 23 and 24 weeks, you do worse than if you're born at 25 weeks and more. Okay, that's not a shock to anybody. But look what we do learn. If you have no events, by that I mean nobody predicted you're going to die and your head ultrasound is not abnormal, then gestational age disappears. The likely outcome is independent of gestational age if you simply use a trial of therapy as your predictor. And so this, we would argue, is the way to counsel parents. It's much better than what we knew here, which is that it's 40 or 50 or something like percent in terms of a bad outcome. Here's what Bree Andrews has done in the last couple of years. It's terrific stuff. Basically, what you do is you go online, and my fellows do this one before they go over to the OB side, and they say, okay, so we know the estimated gestational age, we know the estimated birth weight, we know whether the baby's a boy or a girl, we know whether or not the mother's got an antenatal steroid, you punch those numbers in, and you get a number out. This is the likely survival. This is the likely survival unimpaired. And sometimes my kids will use that. Indeed, when we've surveyed how many neonatologists use it, and basically all neonatologists use it. Okay. And what I'm trying to tell you is they're wrong to use it. And I'm going to tell you why. Okay. These are 19 patients in our place who died before NICU discharge. The purples are what we predicted after a trial of therapy, and the black crosses or diamonds are what was predicted by the Tyson calculator before they were born. And the point to be made here is that they're pretty good fit. There are a couple of kids, okay, who we predicted were going to do well, who didn't. They died. But for the most part, the fit here is quite good. The NICHD calculator, the black diamonds, and Bree's trial of therapy indicators, which is just simply a prediction of die by the caretakers and an abnormal head ultrasound, okay, fit well. Here's 35 kids who survived with normal outcomes. The purple squares, that's what the trial of therapy said. The trial of therapy said, these kids are going to do pretty good. And with only two exceptions, they did good. But look at the black diamonds. A lot of them had really low predictions of likely good outcome before they were born. And these are the kinds of data we'd like to show to say, hey, you know, maybe a trial of therapy is a better way to individualize accurately your predictions of how patients are going to do, better than anything we know about flipping a coin before birth. Okay, so here's a nice analogy, and I like to show this because my son is a co-author on this paper. I'll show you the paper in a second. How many people here know anything about sports betting? Yeah, some of you know about sports betting. Okay, so I'll give you a hint in sports betting. One of the rules is you have to place the bet before the game starts. Right? Okay. And what if you didn't? What if I let you bet continuously during the game? What if you knew that the Yankees were up by 3 runs before Mariano Rivera was coming in the 9th? Don't you think you'd be more accurate in predicting that the Yankees were going to be winning the game than if you had to bet before? You'd become better at predicting the winner as time passed. And here's data. These data were published in ACTA. My son did this because he's got nothing to do in his job. So he looked at, I think, 400-some-odd baseball games and the likelihood of winning, okay, if you're leading after the inning. So if you're leading after the first, it's about 50-50. But if you're leading in the 8th, it's about 94% that you're going to win the game. Okay. And then he had nothing else to do, so he looked at 135 professional soccer matches. Okay. And here the likelihood of winning is down to about a third at the beginning because you can tie in a soccer match. Okay. But by the end, if you're winning in the 90th minute, you're 94% likely. And obviously, if you've won the game at the end of extra time, you've won the game. Okay. So you're a better predictor while the game is going on. If we let you bet on baseball or soccer while the match was going on, you'd do a lot better than the pre-match line. Why don't we do the same for the parents of extremely low gestational age babies? Why don't we let the babies declare themselves? And we'll know much better with 96% accuracy, better than 50-50. Okay, so what have we learned? If your outcome variable is die in the NICU or be an impaired survivor, then you don't have to decide at birth. Time will help sort things out. Now, the moral worth of dying versus being an impaired survivor is not settled. Indeed, this is where I argue a lot of neonatal and perhaps adult ethics ICU research needs to go. Okay, survival from the NICU neurologically intact, usually everybody values that. That's sort of what everybody's hoping for. Survival from the NICU neurologically impaired, that's what the neonatologists fear. But when you actually survey either the children or their parents, and Sarosh Segal has been doing this for 40 years now, the children and the parents seem much happier with their lives than either the docs or the nurses ever would have anticipated, which is interesting, weird, many people don't believe it, but if you don't believe it, you have some obligation to demonstrate it because Sarosh has done. Go ahead. So that's a terrific question. Yes, being vegetative. Absolutely right, Tracy, and that's a terrific. So let me just finish, because I only have one or two slides, and then that could be the first question, because it's a terrific question. Okay, death in the NICU after initial resuscitation. So Marin is sitting in the back, is doing this as part of her fellowship project. You're in the NICU, you get a lot of things done to you, you're on a vent for a long time, a couple of days, a couple of weeks, a couple of months, and you still die. How do the parents feel about that? Are they miserable because the docs have tortured their baby? Or are they grateful that the docs have spent and the nurses have spent so much time trying to help them? That's a really interesting question. And finally, death without resuscitation or comfort care. We have no data on whether there's anything like buyer's remorse, whether or not parents a year or two later feel guilty that they didn't try. We just don't know. So the final ethical exhortation for the young docs in the room, process matters. Don't abandon your patients. That's what it means to be an attending. And I thank you. So there are questions, but let's talk to Tracy's question, which is a terrific question. What do you want to say about various levels of neurologic impairment? Because at some level, it's a key question for neonatology. So there are a bunch of things I can say, and I won't keep anybody who has to leave, just feel free to leave. So Annie Janvier has done some terrific work where she has sent surveys to docs, to nurses, to medical students, to anthropology graduate students, to basically any group of people she can get to answer these questions. And she gives them 8 different scenarios, and the scenarios are graded by likelihood of survival is 50-50 for 4 of them, and 5% survival to 95% die for the other 4. And then the likelihood of neurologic impairment is also 50-50 for 4 of them, and 5% normal and 95% impaired for those. And she has pretty thick descriptions of what they're going to be. Like, a seven-year-old with CP, non-ambulatory, can't go to school, blind and deaf, okay, who now is in a car accident, okay, or a 24-weeker just born, or a full-term baby who has brain hemorrhage, or a three-month-old with meningitis, or a 50-year-old adult with recurrent malignancy, or an 80-year-old person with repeated strokes. So there are eight stories like that. And then she asks people, if they all came to your ER at once, which one would you resuscitate first, which one last? Okay, and she asks, if the parents came to you and said, don't resuscitate, or the family came to you, don't resuscitate, would you accede to their request, or would you ignore the request, and do you think the resuscitation is in the patient's best interest? Okay, so this is pretty straightforward. Okay, and what she finds is, in Annie's words, that everybody hates preemies. That everybody hates preemies. So the 24-weeker is 50-50 likely to be surviving, and 50-50 likely to have any degree of impairment at all, versus your MDI and your PDI are both greater than 70. And yet, they were ranked second to last. Only the 80-year-old with multiple recurrent strokes lower. And the 7-year-old with pre-existing CP and neurodevelopmental impairment, who is now in a new car accident, was ranked like in the middle. So that it looks as if preemies don't have the same claim on us as a population that older children do, that adults do. And it's not until you get to the end of your lifespan that adults begin to lose that claim on us that we should continue to try and resuscitate them. So the data on what percentage of NICU survivors are really terribly vegetative? Okay. And the answer is about 5 or 10% of the survivors. The most common NICU neurologic complication for NICU survival is 10 points of chance of bonus. Yeah, and it's actually ADD. Okay, so it's executive function disorders or those kind of things. And many parents who have children who have ADD at times feel frustrated with them, but as a general principle, they don't vote to kill them. Okay, and so it's probably thought, even by the parents, in the best interest of those children to be alive. Okay, so the question is, how bad a cognitive disability do you have to have before parents transform their vision from one of rooting for the kid to rooting against the kid? And in the NICU, the outcomes are 90% at a minimum of NICU survivors won't be that bad. Okay. And so with that, you can go from there. Other questions? We have a little time, but I don't know. If people have to leave at one, feel free. Okay, Dan.
Yeah, so I thought you were going to talk more about predicting devastating neurological consequences, because that you said up front that that was something you wanted to avoid. And apparently it doesn't occur very often.
Well, not devastating, but complications are real. So, you see, it depends on, so Ken, how much of your practice is filled with ADHD?
Yeah, well, I'm not talking ADHD.
Ah, so if you're talking really devastated,
my PICU is filled
with my ex-graduates. But think of how small your PICU is compared to either my NICU, or think about the fact that there are many, many more NICUs in the world than there are PICUs in the world. I mean, most community PICUs are just filled with asthma patients, but not yours.
Right, but it seems that you would get very different answers if you asked parents up front, if you're pretty certain about a devastating neurological consequence, would you want to continue in aggressive care, versus 5 years later you have this child and are you pleased with the outcome?
Yes.
And so I think, and the question is, should we allow people early on, if we know that they'll probably change their mind in 5 years because, you know, they love this child, or should we let them decide early on, I want to stop now because I don't want to have to deal with this.
So the both parts are terrific questions, and I'll take them both in order. The first one is, how good are we at predicting really, really bad neurologic outcomes? And the answer there is, we're not great, but there are so few that I can't tell you how bad they are, because it's only 10% of this. So there's a couple of hundred kids in this group, and we've done it again, so we now have, let's say, 400 kids from our own institution. So of the survivors, so that's, I don't know, there aren't very many kids who are really badly impaired. And you'd have to sit and talk with Mike Massal a bit about how bad do you have to be before it crosses either the doc's mind or the parent's mind that we shouldn't have done this. Okay, that's the guilt that neonatologists feel. It's not the guilt that Saroj Sehgal finds that parents feel. Now, the other part of your question was a terrific question, and it's important for the fellows to hear it. It has to do with sort of this, when people don't like our data, they don't like it for two reasons. One is they think it's too soft. Intuitions are sloppy, they're malleable. And so what I say to people is, fine, you don't have to like our predictor. Find one of your own. The point to be made is that trial of therapy is a better way to do this than antenatally. Let the baby declare themselves. You pick one. Pick a prostaglandin H5 level or something like that and figure it out for yourself. You could feel free to do that, but it's important that you do it. But the other part of your question is this bonding issue, that if the parents let the baby live and then bond to the baby, they'll be less likely to stop than before they started. And everybody's nodding because it seems to make sense. And my question to you is, implicit in your question was this idea that that's bad, that you shouldn't let people bond to a baby and then not let the kid go the way they would have been willing to let the kid go before they started. And the more you think about that, the weirder that argument is. This idea that people can't have ethical growth, that their lives can't change, that people are bound by what happens before they start. The classic example is Christopher Reeve, right? The guy who played Superman, who was a horseback guy, and he knew that it was a risk that if he jumped horses, he would fall on his neck and break himself. And he wrote all kinds of ex-ante things. If I fall on my neck, don't resuscitate me. I don't want to do this. Okay, and he did fall on his neck, and he became a quad. And of course, everybody ignored him, and they ventilated him, and he came back, and he lived for about 7 years or something like that. And was his life filled with, oh my goodness, you should have let me die? And the answer was, no, it wasn't. He became a spokesperson for quads and stuff like that. And so this idea that people can't change and somehow their earlier ethical intuitions are more valid than their subsequent ones strikes me as weird.
Yeah, I'm not saying that we should take one over there. I'm questioning then, should we give people the choice at that moment, or should we inform them that even if this person is devastated, you'll probably learn to love them?
That would be terrific. And I had a fellow a long time ago, his name is Bob Hipps, who was a fellow with us and then got out of the field because he couldn't bring himself to deal with exactly the question you're asking, which is, how do you accurately inform families of what it's like to have an impaired child? Do you take them to Mantino, back when Mantino had, you know, homes for impaired children, and you say, hi, here's what your kid's going to look like? Or do you show them a Downs kid on TV and say, here's what your kid's going to look like? It's virtually impossible to do. And we're not so good at predicting the really, really bad ones from the not so bad ones who are still not normal. It's an impossible question for us at the moment to answer, although it's an important one, I completely believe it. Jesse.
Bill, so even if you push your prediction rules into the 90%+
yep.
range,
it's a terrific question, Jesse. Yes. Yes. So it's a terrific question, and certainly we've experienced it both on Jesse's side and on our side as well. So the short answer, the sort of the cop-out ethics answer is, it's fine with me. I'm giving the most accurate data I can. They can make whatever decision they can, and I'll support it. Now, that sounds a little blasé. There's a part of it that's true, okay? But think, okay, and Jesse is clearly the person to both engage in this and tease about this. What's your alternative? Well, you have a couple of alternatives. One alternative is to give them the numbers and just be okay with whatever they say. The other is to, Will's young, but he's learning these tricks already. So I told you this morning you shouldn't lie, but you can be somewhere between deceptive and ambiguous about, right, about how we counsel families. So there's no hope. Well, do you really mean there's no hope or there's just a really little hope? And so you yourself, like we do as well, frame these discussions with some degree. You shouldn't, you write this down with a pen. Don't explicitly lie. That's like bad. Even Siegs would agree with that. Okay, but having said that, there are ways of framing discussions. And yeah, if you're asking me, do I think that it's better for parents to know that it's 96 versus 4 compared to that it's 50-50 for a likely outcome? Yeah, I think that's helpful. Now, do I think that it's going to be determinative and that everybody who gets a 96 versus 4 is going to say, oh, that's bad odds, I'm not going to do it? No, I think there's going to be people who are going to hang on to the 4%. And what I say there is, in my NICU, that's fine. I got them. Yeah, I can name them in our NICU today. I won't, but I could. It happens at some level 4% of the time. And that's okay. It's not too much money. Okay, it's not like the adult unit. Javad.
When you say end of life care, I think I understand it until I try to understand each word.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you could, as much as you could, clarify. End of, when is the onset of end of? In other words, you decide now in this chat, it is the end of, onset of. The second thing, a little more difficult, and you said it, life. Some of the kids you and I saved with intracerebral, as I followed them up, I didn't see much of a life in these children. It was a biological life. And it was as if it was the end of life of the mother. In other words, they liked that child.
Yeah.
But their life was gone. And second, when you say care, what do you mean by care? You mean send them home and let them die? You mean you are going to continue to do some kind of care? What does care mean? If you, these three words, a little bit clarify, I appreciate.
Sure. So the care part I'll take first, Javad. Javad, you may know, is a neurosurgeon and an eminent one and has been doing neurosurgery for a long time now. The vast majority of our NICU survivors are not in your world, okay? They need care in a very different sense. They need love from their parents, they need support, they may need some meds, they need early intervention, but they don't need a lot of medical stuff. Some of them have lung disease and need some oxygen weaning and maybe some diuretics, but they're not overwhelmingly needy of medical interventions, even the ones like with BPD. The number of kids who we have who go home on home TPN, I don't know, two every 2 years or something like that. And the kids who have shunts, yeah, we have some, but we don't have that many. Now, for the mothers who feel that that their lives are over, the data are that when you ask the mothers, there aren't very many. Most of the mothers love these kids. Come, everybody is welcome to come. In September, third Sunday in September, to the NICU reunion. You know, we have 600-700 people come back. Okay, most of these people are pretty happy. Now, maybe it's a selected group. Maybe all the ones who are miserable don't come back. But the ones, so Jaydeep was just here, the emotion that all of the attendings have is at some level one of puzzlement, because we're looking at these kids and they come back and they're 12 or 13 years old, and they're clearly impaired. They limp, or they have CP, or they're cognitively imperfect, or they don't speak. And the parents come up to us, and they're ecstatic. Doc, I'm so grateful. Look at how well, you know, Johnny or Janie is doing. You know, and we're thinking to ourselves, you know, we're ecstatic, and we're happy, and comforting, and cheering with the parents, and we're thinking, wow. You know, people are really resilient, that they can be so loving of a child, that nobody goes into pregnancy hoping for. And so what I'm trying to do here is to give you guys a feel for, we are docs, we are medical professionals, this is what we do for a living. The easy ones are the well babies and the normal ones. These are the hard ones. And the question is, can we gather some data to help parents in their hard decision making? With that, I'll stop. I can sit down here for a bit if people